That song goes all the way to the climax, of course, so, of the song. Good morning. So today we're looking at a defense of abortion. I hope you don't mind discussing it. And our star philosopher associated with this is Judith Jarvis Thompson, who's still alive and 89 years old, according to Wikipedia, which is never wrong about anything, I suppose. To get started, I'll play this wonderful video clip. The fetus frightening room.
Yeah.
Back then, that was video format so that you could watch. That's a segment from the Monty Python Meaning of Life film, if you're curious. by the way, the very last class is a double session instead of two single sessions like we usually have during the week. And it's for finals, but all my requirements, you email me, so there's no final test here that we go through. So attendance is not mandatory for you that have conflicts. That often happens. But also, I have to be here to finish off the accreditation requirement for the course, so I will be here. What I would usually do, of course, is watch a movie that whoever does come to watch the movie get to vote on, and that could be one of the ones that I could play because I have the DVD, as you can imagine. Okay, so the article that we have in the text for today is pretty famous. It was written just before the Roe v. Wade decision of the Supreme Court by a couple years. I'm not sure whether the Supreme Court justices read it or if it had an impact on the case. I'm sure you're all familiar with Roe v. Wade as the turning point in federal law where, because of the privacy of the woman, abortion was going to be allowed because it's a privacy issue between the woman and her doctor, essentially. That's my rough approximation of how that worked. Of course, that doesn't mean that the privacy of the woman affects late-term abortions, right? Those are certainly an issue. But basically, up to the, I think, what, three months was an opportunity for the woman to have an abortion if they wanted. What's kind of an interesting side to this is the woman that was, that the court, that decision was based on, later on herself changed her mind about her acceptance of abortion and became a member of a group that tried to stop it until she died. But that's kind of interesting. But the article that we get from Judith Thompson introduces an odd concept that kind of like Thomas Nagel and his article about, you know, what's it like to be a bat. Kind of a funny little puzzle that made his article famous, even though he wasn't, remember, the one that introduced that question. But she does invent this idea of the woman waking up in the morning and discovering that she had been kidnapped by a music society that had discovered that she was the only perfect match for this famous violinist who had a kidney disease. And so what they did was they hooked the violinist up to the woman to save the violinist. So the woman has been kidnapped, wakes up, and discovers that a violinist, a famous violinist, not just any ordinary violinist or just any ordinary person, but a world famous violinist, is now plugged into her renal system. She's stuck. She can't get rid of this violinist without killing him. If they unhook the violinist, right, he'll die. And so she's faced with a prima facie situation where she's responsible for the life of this other person, whether she likes it or not, right? So obviously this is a metaphor for the woman that hadn't planned on being pregnant, right? But discovers, of course, that she is, and now has another human life dependent on her, whether she wanted it or not. And so she uses that as the foil against which she argues that essentially, since the woman didn't volunteer for this and she's under no real obligation to keep that violinist alive, she could insist on being disconnected from the violinist. Does that make sense? That's her basic argument. So lots of questions, of course, come up. Is it a surprise that someone ends up... This is, of course, just one possible scenario. As you can tell, it sounds like a cooperative effort between two individuals that could result in a pregnancy. I mentioned this song earlier. I don't know if you had ever heard this song or not. By the way, the one that was actually banned, this was Serge's second wife. His first wife was Bridget. And it's kind of interesting if you listen to the two songs and you have to decide for yourself who's better. That could be funny if you're... So he sings this duet with two different women. Bridget Bardot, his first wife. Have you ever heard of her, Bridget Bardot? You should look her up. She's very famous. She's still alive. Loves animals. Became famous in French movies when she was very young. She was too young to be in some of the movies that she was in, so that caused controversy. So, that's one scenario. But I happen to know from talking with people that you can be surprised and end up pregnant without expecting it. In fact, you might not find out for even 3 months. Is that right? I can't ask anyone. Anthony, I don't know if you've ever been pregnant. I didn't think so. It's... The only male I know of that ever was pregnant was Arnold when he was in a movie where he ended up pregnant for some reason. Anybody saw that movie? I think it was called, I don't even remember the name of the movie, but for some reason Arnold ended up pregnant. And the kids would I don't know if he was a policeman or a teacher in a kindergarten or something, but in any case, the kids, I remember asking him if it was a tumor, and he said, "It's not a tumor." Kindergarten cop? Okay.
He wasn't pregnant.
He wasn't pregnant?
No,
he was pregnant in a different movie. Okay. Junior. Okay. I've actually never seen either one, but I just remember that line, "It's not a tumor." Because that's a classic Arnold, the Gubernator, kind of. You guys all know Arnold Schwarzenegger, right? Not just from the Conan the Barbarian, the musical segment that I played earlier. Okay, so I'm sure you're familiar with the whole concept of becoming pregnant. Some people know it, some people don't, some people plan on it. Do have personal experience wanting to have children. I think I mentioned we adopted our children because we could not figure out how to make them. We spent years trying to do that. We had medical help, and it didn't help. It did give us a letter, an official letter from a doctor saying, give this couple children because they can't make them. And that helped us adopt the children that we did get. So you could get married, plan on having children, and end up not being able to do that. And in this famous document, which is et humanae vitae, means human life, that's the title of a papal letter, an encyclical letter, from Pope Paul VI, and this was from 1968. It was after, I believe, Vatican II, which was the second main conference called in relatively recent times, that changed policies in the church, where the cardinals all come together and have a discussion about that. And this one is about the problem of abortion and how the church, the Orthodox Catholic Church, then would respond to those new technologies and things, like the pill, for example, which it's kind of interesting. The pill I believe there are some synthetics now, but the original source and main source still, as far as I know, for the drug is from pregnant mares, horses that have been impregnated and are dehydrated so that the urine is very concentrated. And from that urine, they are able to make the estrogen replacement drug, Premarin, which, notice it stands for pregnant mare urine, right? Which then is ingested by women and fools their bodies into thinking that they are pregnant, the body. Believes it's pregnant, and that prevents them from going into the sequence that enables them to become pregnant, right? So it's a preventive measure. It's kind of interesting that when the pill started becoming more and more popular, so it was the 1950s, as the pill became more and more popular, an odd result that might not have been related, but seemed to be, was that divorces increased at the same time. There's an interesting book by Lionel Tiger. And I know that sounds absolutely crazy. Who in their right mind would name their child Lionel Tiger? But his book, The Decline of Males, pointed out that when they used I think they were called Nor implants or whatever, they could put them into the wrists of great apes, and it would hold up for 3 months. And so they would put these Nor implants in the great apes on a particular island, starting with the four favorites of the dominant alpha male. And immediately after implanting them, the dominant male quit attending those four favorites and instead selected four other favorites from the tribe, or whatever you call the group, right, of monkeys. Great apes. They were larger than little Reese's or whatever. In any case, that's kind of interesting, because no one told him what they had done. It was clearly a case of him somehow sensing that there was something different about his four favorites, and he abandoned them for four others. 3 months later, they put implants in the new favorites and let the old ones expire in the old favorites, and immediately he switched his attentions from the new favorites to the old favorites. And so after that, they decided to put implants in all of the females on the island. Of course, the great apes on that island were trapped there. And immediately, all the male members of the group went bonkers because they basically weren't interested in any of the females. So that caused, of course, an interesting analysis. Why was that the case? And they basically concluded that the only thing that they could have enabled them to know the status of the females was their smell. That the pheromones, right? Are you familiar with pheromones? I guess everyone's familiar with pheromones today. We didn't used to know about them. It's a relatively recent discovery about mammals, pheromones. I mean, we use them now like to control insects and things of that sort. If you put female pheromones out in the field, the male insects will just gather around that and not be attracted to the actual females of that species, and as a result, it declines the numbers of that insect, right? So it's nice because it's not poisonous to the ecology, and yet at the same time, it has a powerful effect on the population of a particular target species, etc. Of course, the argument was that humans are not affected by pheromones. After all, we're rational beings. We're attracted to mates for different reasons than the odors associated with those persons. But as far as I understand it today, it's not an issue at all. We've got enough studies to show that, yes, we're actually animals too, mammals too, and so we're attracted to mates because of pheromones. By the way, it's females attract males with pheromones. Apparently, males do not attract females with pheromones. They only, because the females spread the pheromones in the air, and so males can sense them and are attracted. By the way, it's subliminal, so you know, it's not like you're sitting on a park bench somewhere and a woman goes by and you go, No, that's not how that happens. It's kind of famous, though, you know, that if you have a pregnant, or not a pregnant, but a female dog that's in heat, right? All the male dogs in the neighborhood are attracted to the house. You've heard of that. That's pretty. Doesn't mean, of course, that if you have a daughter who's in her cycle, that all the neighborhood males start gathering outside the front on your lawn and not know why, right? You know, I'm not suggesting that. But so that's kind of interesting. But with the advent of the pill, what was interesting is that apparently the males knew that a difference in the mates, and so they were no longer attracted to them. So if you put that together, as Lionel Tiger does in this book, with the possibility that that was what was causing a decline in marriages, which, by the way, they're no longer in decline because there's so few marriages left that there's not very many divorces anymore, because no one gets married anymore anyway. So that's kind of, well, no, that's not true. I have lots of students that I see posted later on getting married to their girlfriends that, or the boyfriends, whatever, from or other. You don't have to, et cetera, you know. The LGBT thing plus, right? LGBT plus. You know, there's all sorts of, according to Judith Butler, there's like hundreds of various types of genders out there. It's quite confusing. In any case, so the interesting aspect of the pill is that the pill, of course, I remember sitting in a clinic years ago and looking at the wall, and there was, I think, upwards of 50 different types of available technologies that could be used to prevent that sort of thing. Although the oddest commercial I noticed most recently was a commercial for a group of young people who pointed out that I'm on the pill, I'm on the pill, I'm on the pill, but it's not that pill. The pill they're on prevents them from getting AIDS from their well, you get the idea. That's kind of, it was an odd commercial for me, you know, because that's relatively new, that sort of thing. So where does this go? So we have lots more technological control over getting pregnant today. And this was already happening at the time of Vatican II, and so it was discussed. What's the church's official stand on these various technologies, etc.? And I want to tie this in now to the importance of the meta-narrative, or the meaning of life that you believe in. And if you think, oh, does that meta-narrative that you believe in have an impact on your interpretation of art? Of course it does. And your interpretation of practically everything, actually. Well, of course, in this respect, if you think that your meta-narrative is what's going to define what a person is, who you are, right? What your place is in the universe and how you maintain that place, it's certainly also going to have an impact on your interpretation of whether or not a fetus is a person or not, right? And by the way, what is a person? Not sure if I mentioned that myself yet. I have puzzled over the definition of a person. Class notes, other items. What is a person? And I stole, by the way, that picture is a relative of mine. By the way, the baby was born, and I, of course, on Facebook see lots of pictures of it doing all sorts of things. And I had permission from her to post that picture. She was very proud of that picture. That's a beautiful picture. But so I stole the definition of a person here from two different philosophers. One was John Rawls, whose attempt to define what I'm looking at as a person here was really an attempt to define a citizen in his works. And the other philosopher is Peter Singer, who is still alive and famous. And one of his most famous associations is with the Great Ape Project, because Peter Singer is not only a vegetarian, maybe a vegan, I'm not sure, but he's also very concerned with life. Chickens, for example, how we treat chickens, whether or not we should slaughter chickens for food, whether we should slaughter animals for food, he's against it, etc. So Peter Singer, pretty famous professor at Princeton, and his definition was of a person. And so when I'm looking at kind of combining them and then adding a little bit of my own to this, what is a person? Notice that it's not genetically human beings. That's not a necessity. Instead, what's an important aspect of this is the way society defines them and the way they define themselves. So a individual is a person when it has the characteristic that it interacts with other individuals that consider themselves as individuals, and the type of individual each is viewed by each individual as defined by the other individuals. In other words, it's a social contract, basically, with the others. That is, they are individuals but are dependent on one another for their sense of what that means. Two, it is self-reflecting, which means you can think to yourself like Hamlet, to be or not to be, that's the question, right? You have to have at least that modern standing, which means you have to have language. It has to be the language that, of course, enables you to have that app that enables you to think about yourself. And when you're thinking about yourself, you're thinking about all the cognitive things that you've been taught from your society to apply to yourself as who you are, right? So Bill Jamison, 206, 428, 256, ugly, sort of retired, it's very confusing. Four children, married since 1972, etc. Right, all those things, that basically my vita, or my resume, or my e-portfolio, any of that sort of stuff, would be like, and other things too, of course, right? So self-reflecting, it's a requirement for us to think of an individual as a person. By the way, this suggests that there are many human beings who are not modern persons in this respect because they haven't been raised with the right language in order to speak that kind of self-reflecting set of concepts. So there's perhaps most people in the world are not modern persons in this respect. And that would of course be indicative of why they wouldn't be in a society where they think of the government as a social contract and that they have rights. Most people in the world do not believe they have rights unless they've been in contact with modern Western societies and have learned that vocabulary, speak French at least, or English, or something of that sort. The people generally don't think of themselves this way, and that would mean that they're not self-reflecting as far as this requirement. So strictly speaking, they're not persons by this definition. And three, it does what the others that define it consider appropriate to its position in relationship to them. So, when we think of the inalienable rights or unalienable rights, of life, liberty, freedom, all that stuff, medical care, perhaps, today, right, we argue over, you can take yourself out of the contract by misbehaving. And Thompson points this out, too, right, that you can define yourself right on out of that personhood status by, say, threatening the life of the woman. If you're a fetus, and you're endangering her, right? That doesn't become a problem. We recognize the church doesn't, essentially, because they're very concerned about that borderline. But for many individuals, if the woman is endangered by the continuing pregnancy, that's not a problem for them, even if they, in general, might be against abortion. They might feel like, well, that's really important. We have to save the woman from whatever's wrong with... does it get that way when it's a problem with the child and you know that the child isn't going to have a good life? So it doesn't put the woman in danger, but nonetheless, for example, that the child is not going to be healthy, et cetera. Remember, Sarah Palin, that was something that really endeared her to a lot of her supporters when she chose to have the child that they knew from medical tests was going to be damaged, right? You're familiar. Everybody knows Sarah Palin? Yes? Okay. So it's been already years ago. So okay. So what are the things that can take you right out of the contract? If you're not worthy of the respect because you don't act the way you're supposed to. For example, if you're violent, killing other people, we can at least restrict your freedom, put you in jail, and maybe in some states, of course, even execute you, right? Another is if you're working with a group and being violent, we tend to blow you up whichever way we can manage, using a drone or something, or sending in a SEAL team, you name it. You know, we call those people terrorists. If you are a parasitic organism endangering the life of a woman, that's the fetus problem, right? If it's not worthy of respect because it is not thriving. Now think about this. This is a real interesting problem for us. Well, we have a group of people that are not thriving. They're literally unable to feed themselves, for example. Do we have an obligation to feed them, or can we go along with Malthus, as you recall, Reverend Malthus' argument that this is just nature taking its course and you're only going to make the situation worse by feeding people that can't feed themselves, etc., right? You know, are we actually obligated to think of those individuals as worthy of being fed by the rest of the community? And are they persons? So you think about that impact on mostly, I would say, liberals that are concerned about feeding people in a famine or rescuing them in all sorts of situations. I mean, it goes both ways, of course. I mean, if you lived in the Paradise Valley, I think, in California, and your home was burned and a lot of your relatives died, et cetera, right? California, I think you're clearly a modern person, and yet at the same time, what's the obligation of the rest of our community in order to help put you back on your feet? And if we don't support that, boy, what happens if we have an earthquake here of maybe 8.4 or something, 9 point something? You know, what happens to us when all of our structures collapse and we're totally devastated? Wouldn't we hope for the United States in general to help us out, and so on? Seven, it is not worthy of the respect because it doesn't act like a person, because it's a pig or some other animal. So if you think of it, you go to the state fair and you see the pigs sitting there, is it a happy pig? You know, yes, you know, it looks all happy, all the little piglets all nursing and everything, and right above its head is the price that it got for per pound. That poor pig has no clue, right? But actually, that's what the pigs are being raised for food, not because they're persons expected to go to college and become lawyers, right? That some pigs actually go to college, become lawyers, that's a totally different issue, right? Oh, sorry, that was a joke. Maybe not. And eight, it is not worthy of respect because it's a rock or a tree. You know, it's part of the environment. So this definition is an attempt to cover all those that are persons and all those that are not by the eight requirements there. So that's when I talk about a person, I'm thinking of, well, I mean, you could think of other issues associated with that. For example, Mr. Spock in the Star Trek series, right? Mr.